He knows a lot about the science stuff, Professor Dave Explains.
Hey guys, so for this practice problem, we have a little two-step sequence here. We've got this substrate with two different kinds of carbonyl functionality, and we are going to run this through two reactions, one with strong base, and then two with these conditions here. So try and think critically and see if you can get the right answer here. Okay, so let's take a look at this. We've got this six carbon substrate, right? One, two, three, four, five, six. Six carbons. We have an aldehyde functional group and a ketone functional group. And we are doing this, the first reaction is simply strong base. We've got some hydroxide. And so ideally the first thing that we think of is enolate chemistry, right? We know that with an aldehyde or a ketone in the presence of strong base like hydroxide, those are your classic conditions to do some aldol chemistry. And so we know that we're going to make an enolate. Now the thing is, we've got alpha protons here and here and here, but there's one clue here. There are two carbonyls, so we know that we're opening up the possibility of some intramolecular chemistry, right? Because anytime it is possible for something like an enolate, in this case, to attack another portion of the molecule, that is going to be tremendously kinetically favorable, because it doesn't then have to find something else in solution to collide with. The other functional group that's going to interact with is right there, ready to go. So that certainly is going to happen much faster. Now the thing is, ring size is going to dictate the position of enolization, because if we enolize, say, here, right, what size ring is that going to allow us to get? Well, this carbon would have to attack this, so that'd be a 1, 2, 3, 4-membered ring. That's not so good. 4-membered rings are a little bit too small to be favorable. Likewise, if we enolize here, 1, 2, 3, 4, it would attack that carbon, and another 4-membered ring, not so great. But what if we enolize here? Right, we've got some protons there that are enolizable, and if we go ahead and get one of those guys, so let's take our hydroxide, and let's have that go up here. So let's make our enolate. Now we're in a much better position here, because we've got this carbon is going to attack this carbon, and so this is a 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6-membered ring that we're going to make, because this carbon, right, the alpha carbon there, is going to attack this carbonyl carbon. So let's show that happening. We're going to reform that carbonyl. This is going to go over here and attack that. And so we get, well, let's just go ahead and draw the 6-membered ring. So you know what, let me do that. Let's get a little more room. We're going to go over here. So let's draw the 6-membered ring. And now all we have to do is this. So let's say we call this number 1, right? We can just do this like this. We'll just number them. We know that we're making a 6-membered ring, so let's just make the 6-membered ring. Now, carbon 1 is the one that attacked carbon 6, right? So that is our new bond right there. Now, what else is there? Well, on carbon 2, we reformed the carbonyl, right? On carbon 2, this pi bond came back down. So let's draw that. And then 3, 4, 5, nothing. And then on 6, 6 should have that oxyanion now, right? So this was the carbon where we enolized, therefore it is the carbon that did the attacking. It made the bond from 1 to 6, that's our new sigma bond, and then 6 was a carbonyl, now oxyanion, right? So that's that, and then let's just pick up a proton from water and protonate that real quick, and we'll get our aldol addition product. And then we know that from the aldol addition product, we can just go ahead and get the aldol condensation product. So let's take some more base. And let's go ahead and get that proton and kick this off. We're in strong base, so another hydroxide's not going to hurt. And we'll do this. So that is the product of number one. Number one is getting us to this six-membered ring where we have the carbonyl reformed. We've got that pi bond. That's the product there. It was this intramolecular aldol condensation. Now, number two, what does it look like we're going to do here? Well, let's draw these next to each other and in a very particular way, and maybe it will become more apparent. When I draw them this way, it may become a little more apparent what's going to happen. This is a classic, this is a great diene, and therefore this is a dienophile, and we know that we're going to be doing some Diels-Alder chemistry. And this is possible because of this pi bond in the aldol condensation product. So let's go ahead, whenever we're doing Diels-Alder, we can draw these dashed lines just to guide us because we know we're going to be making a new six-membered ring. If you don't get a six-membered ring when you're doing Diels-Alder, something went wrong because it will always make a new six-membered ring. And all we have to do is shuffle these pi electrons around. This pi bond can become the new pi bond. This pi bond can become a new sigma bond. This pi bond can become a new sigma bond. And we are going to get this. We know that this is the new six-membered ring. This is the old six-membered ring. This is still there. We've got that new pi bond, and there has to be a bridgehead carbon there. Okay, so that is going to be our product. Just to really quickly clarify what we did here, these are the new bonds, right? We've got these bonds here. We made two new carbon-carbon sigma bonds in doing the Diels-Alder, right? That's always going to be the case. We're going to make a new, the four carbons that were participating in, or sorry, the six carbons that were participating in pi bonds are now in a six-membered ring together. So that is these six carbons. But the thing is this, there was this fifth carbon on the diene, and that's not going anywhere, right? That better still be in your product. So that's going to be a bridgehead carbon right there, because it's not part of the new six-membered ring, but the initial five-membered ring still exists. So we have this five-membered ring in addition to this new six-membered ring. And then the rest of this molecule should also still be there. Nothing happened to the rest of that. So when you're doing Diels-Alder like this, whatever you're doing with your carbons, you definitely want to make sure you don't gain or lose any carbon material. So say if you didn't have that bridgehead carbon because you forgot about it, you could count your carbons and say, oh, I've got 12, but over here, 10, but over here we had 11 because 6 and 5, so that would tip you off. You'd say, well, I must have lost something, and then you could remember that bridgehead carbon. So that's the deal with the Diels-Alder reaction. And so once again, this was a little bit of a clever one. We had to be a little bit insightful. We had to say, I know that I have this compound with two different carbonyl functionality, with two different kinds of carbonyl functionality reacting with strong base. We knew that we were going to be doing some enolate chemistry, some aldol condensation. Specifically, we're going to do intramolecular aldol condensation. And that guided us as to the location where enolization took place, because it had to be the location that would allow for a stable ring to form. So four-membered ring's no good, but we enolized here, and we were able to cyclize and get a six-membered ring. And that's how we got all the way to the aldol condensation product for number one. So number one was our intramolecular aldol condensation, and then just reacting with this diene and some heat, those are perfect conditions for Diels-Alder. We had our diene and our dienophile, and this was our Diels-Alder product. So this is the product of this two-step sequence. Thanks for watching, guys. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. Support me on Patreon so I can keep making content. And as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.